to the world of Doctor Who, the Time Lord that explores the galaxy while on his time-traveling adventures. Welcome to the world of the longest-running science fiction series in history, with your co-hosts Susan Backstrom, David Grunt, Matthew Rose, Tom Diamond, and Craig Johnson. They explore the classic series from its humble beginnings in 1963 and tracking through time to every episode up to the current day. This is the Doctor Who retrospective, where a legend will never die.
Welcome to the Literary License Podcast. Tonight we are talking about the Sensorites with William Hartnell from 1964, and I've got Matthew Rose with me.
Yes, it's good to be back from the Oodsphere. Oh, it's not the Oodsphere, it's the Sensorites.
I'm with Mario Heraclius.
Hey, Professor. Oh, wicked. I can't wait.
And I'm joined by Ramona.
Hello, from the USA, watching Doctor Who since 1983 and loving it.
That's so cool. We've got East Finchley suburbs meets USA and North Finchley. And where are you, Matt?
Time and space, and then it's the West Midlands.
So, Matt, what have you been up to recently? What, have you been watching anything?
A long time ago in the galaxy far, far away, there's this thing called The Mandalorian, which is on its finale tomorrow for Series 3. I've been dipping into a lot of Big Finish. The Water on Thursdays, the new Rani Takes the World spin-off, which I'm looking forward to hearing, like, Andrew Mahindra back as Rani Chandra. But hearing that trailer, it's so funny hearing the guy that played Clyde. Every time I try to call his name, it sounds like the guy that was C-3PO. So I'll call him Clyde, so I don't mistake him for Anthony Daniels, even though his name is Daniel Anthony. He sounds exactly the same. It's like no time has changed. But because you're doing First Doctor, which is spooky, I was listening to Stephen Noonan the other day, and the funniest thing he did was like the Hartnell tidbit where he said, we've landed the shops, I mean the ship. And it was like, what? We'd land at the shops. Okay. I like it when they do like the Hartnell tidbits. Yes, as you could tell, I'm still in uniform for work. I've literally got one now after literally 2 months, about, where am I? Month four, and I only got it last month.
And I heard of the Dark Season being rebranded.
Yes. Have you seen what's happened with that in Vortex Mag? He's hinted that's a unit spin-off. He's hinted that the Dark Season's always been in Doctor Who, so he's now hinting that there's going to be units involvement in this new audio.
Right. And I love the Behemoth episodes of the Dark Season.
But can we say it's wonderful that people might think this is a nostalgia year, that Tennant's also doing Ahsoka, and as well as Kate Winslet reprising the Dark Season. It's like everyone's coming back. First, Hayden came back last year for Kenobi with Ewan. Now it's like every greatest hits are returning these last few years.
And what about yourself, Marius? What have you been up to?
So I have actually been watching Dark Season myself last week, because I've decided that every Sunday will be classic DVD night. So I've started off with Dark Season, and I must admit, I absolutely love it. The way it was written, the acting, Kate Winslet, the young Kate Winslet, Marcy Hatter, I always think of her as the Seventh Doctor in that series, especially when it became the Behemoth episodes. I thought that was absolutely fantastic. I've started off with Dark Season. I've been on to Bergerac as well. And also Sunday Night Soap, Howard's Way, which is a sailing soap opera. So I have been diving into the world of the 80s, 90s classic DVDs of late. But I'm actually writing a new short story for July release called Southern Threat, an alien excursion in the Arctic. So watch out for that one in July as well.
Cool. And how about yourself, Ramona? What have you been up to?
I've been up to a bit of gardening this morning. But a long term is writing a lot of fan fiction. Rassilon, the beginning of a legend. Just done page 4 this morning. I've also got something cooking with Susan, different spelling of her name, beginning with an X instead of an S for the masculine of Susan.
Wow.
Something has got me buggered, and that is the line from Ruth Doctor. See that thing down there? That's my ship. It's called a TARDIS. Susan said that she came up with the name of the TARDIS.
Oh, yeah.
So something is
beauty.
So
coming up with I took it as she may have created the name, but it was definitely the doctor that knew what TARDIS was, but the initials, I still believe she made it up. She just said, like, whatever it was, Deb again, she's still going to have her mind wiped between her and what. So Susan still could have done it.
Exactly. But here's where the masculine Susan comes in. She got her own history.
Yeah.
Or
I think they need to explore Susan a bit more. Definitely. She's been overlooked.
Oh, if it was going to be Susan the horse.
Lovely. But if anyone doesn't know, Ramona is a master sculptor and she does TARDIS interiors and they are amazing. Like, amazing. So be sure to check them out. You've got some Facebook pages, isn't it, Ramona?
Yes. Go to my albums and the album titled Builds. And you can scroll through that and see some pictures.
Cool. Right. Well, we'll start with the Sensorites for William Hartnell, and we'll cut to the trailer and we'll be right back.
This is Synopsis for Doctor Who, The Sensorites, airing the 20th of June to the 1st of August, 1964. The TARDIS crew land on a spaceship, where they meet crew members Captain Maitland and Carol Richman, who are on an exploration mission from Earth and are orbiting Sense Spear. However, its inhabitants, the Sensorites, refuse to let them leave orbit. The Sensorites visit and stop the travelers from leaving while sending them on a collision course, which the First Doctor diverts. The travelers then meet Carol's fiancé, John, whose mind has been broken by the Sensorites. Susan Foreman's telepathic mind is flooded with the many voices of the Sensorites who remain scared of the humans and are trying to communicate with her. Meanwhile, the Doctor calculates that the Sensorites attacked the human craft because John, a mineralogist, had discovered a vast supply of molybdenum on Sense Spear. Susan reports that the Sensorites wish to make contact with travelers, asking the crew to board Sense Sphere and reveal that a previous Earth expedition caused them great misery. The Doctor asks the Sensorites to return the TARDIS lock in exchange for visiting the Sense Sphere to speak with the leader. Ian Charleston, Susan, Carol, and John join him. On their journey to Sense Sphere, the party learns that the previous visitors from Earth exploited Sense Sphere for its wealth. Half of them stole the spacecraft, which exploded on takeoff. The Sensorite Council is divided over the issue, inviting the party to Sense Sphere. Some members plot to kill them on arrival, but others believe that the humans can help with the disease that is currently killing many Sensorites. When their first plot is foiled by the other Sensorites, they continue to plot in secret. John's mind is eventually unblocked. Ian contracts the disease that has blighted the Sensorites until he will soon die. It is revealed that he is actually poisoned by drinking water from the aqueduct. The Doctor finds the aqueduct and creates a cure for Ian. The plotting Sensorites capture and then impersonate a Sensorite leader, the Second Elder.
Meanwhile, investigating the aqueduct, the doctor finds strange noises and darkness. He sees and removes deadly nightshade, the cause of the poisoning, and while returning meets an unseen monster. Susan and Ian find him unconscious but unharmed. On recovering, he tells his suspicion that some Sensorites are plotting to kill them. The plotting Sensorites kill the second elder, and one of them replaces him in his position. John tells the others that he knows the lead plotter, but he is now too powerful, so the doctor and Ian go down to the aqueduct to find the poisoners. Elsewhere, a mysterious assailant abducts Carol, Susan, John, and Barbara, eventually find and release her. On discovering the tamper tools, they go into the aqueduct to rescue the doctor and Ian. The leader discovers the plotters a little while later. Ian and Doctor discover that the monsters were actually the survivors of the previous Earth mission, and they have been poisoning the Sensorites. Their deranged commander leads them to the surface where they are arrested by the Sensorites. The Doctor and his party return to the city, pleading clemency for the poisoners. The leader of the Sensorites agrees and sends them back with Maitland, John, and Carol to Earth for treatment. And that is the synopsis for Doctor Who, The Sensorites, which aired the 20th of June to the 1st of August, 1964. Now back to the show.
Hello and welcome to the Literary License Podcast. Tonight we're discussing The Sensorites. So, opening the floor, any thoughts?
Well, for me, the first time I saw it, because I haven't seen it since my VHS tape, it was so slow. For me, it was the slowest story that I have seen from Doctor Who. 6 episodes long, and I'm sorry, guys, I fell asleep in some of them, to be fair with you. Because it didn't go anywhere. It was just not, I wasn't feeling the flow, if you know what I mean, with it. And I understand there was some political essence in the story as well. And I think Susan was standing up for herself in this one as well, because she wanted to go with the Sensorites, but she wasn't allowed to. As well, so it for me, Susan was quite strong. She was adamant, but I just couldn't connect with the story. I couldn't connect with this story, and that's for me. That's my personal truth for that one.
Because the first time the Doctor has instigated something without the cliche of having to be forced to fix something, even though he does say in the episode, I'm not to meddle in the lives of others, but then you think, well, hold on, he sort of is. What did you think of the Sensorites themselves, though?
They were good for what they were, I think, but I think we need a little bit more of them, because didn't come across for me as a villain in such in a state, really. They weren't. Yeah. You know, I just couldn't connect. And that's the very first time for me. Anybody else on the thoughts of the Sensorites at all, Matthew?
Well, go on then. Basically, to be honest, it is exactly what it is on the tin. It's a very strong Susan story because it gives her way more to do, but which is such a shame because this is when Carol Ann's on the way out from the show at this point. I think from an episode standpoint, from a writing point, the concept is good for the having the Sensorites, aliens she can relate to because she feels alienated and ostracized within her own crew. That's why she relates to them. But unfortunately, then you've got this weird, like, war-type clan going on with the Sensor, and it just is so ridiculous. I mean, I love the Sensorites. Look at the design of them. They're definitely, like, what would come for, like, things like the Ood. But when you watch them back, it just felt like their plot made absolutely no sense. It's a fun story, but it definitely is like the New Who stuff, where you watch an episode and you get frustrated at the end of it. And you're like, okay, this was good. But it felt incredibly like a filler for coming to the end of the journey of one companion. It felt like they were just needed to fill time before Carol Ann left, which was in the big Dalek story. Would I have liked more Sensorites? Big Finish have only done one story recently, and funny enough, it was with Susan and the Time War, and they just literally justified like her connection with them on this sense sphere. And it's just like, how on earth, like years later, the Time War version of her, you get a better, meatier story than the actual story that it's come from, same as the Vord. I think personally, though, if you look at like the Hartnell era, it's a fun era, but this whole first series does have flaws. One minute, you've got companions sidelined, and then some are getting the short straw, some are getting the better straw. This episode, I can't really gauge like how the Doctor was when I watched it like the first time, and I was just like, oh, this story was definitely Susan's story. Everyone else just felt like they were guest characters this week. It was like Susan, Susan who this week for this episode? Like, you know, when people joke about Clara, but honestly, I love the fact that it's Susan's like strongest episode, but it's a weak story for Doctor Who, because they all get overshadowed by her story with the Sensorites. It's like Doctor Who and the cameos this week. But yeah, it's good. The music is great as always for like the Radiophonic Workshop. The atmosphere was great. It's just the Sensorite war that doesn't make any sense to me. That guy that literally was pot stirring everything. That's the only problem I had with it. Really, it was like, who is this guy? They're supposed to be really nice and loud noises hurt them. I mean, yet this guy's like spears and nothing phases him. It's like it contradicts itself each episode. But hey ho, that's just the opening thoughts.
Because in the Aztecs last week, when we covered it, it was Susan who had 2 weeks off. And I think this week, this adventure was Barbara's time to have 2 weeks off because she was hardly seen.
Yes, I agree with that. I didn't see Barbara at all, to be fair.
Unless she was drained out from the Aztecs, because that performance was amazing. So I don't know if that might be why. But yeah, she's in orbit with Captain Maitland.
My thoughts on the Sensorites were that even though family groups were mentioned, I saw them as an exploration of unisex life form wearing Dr. Denton's. And they were all lookalikes. You really couldn't tell Cracker Jack from the other character or the other one or the other one, unless you had the sash of office. Mm. And they made a big deal about who was who could tell who was who without the sash of office. And I kind of enjoyed them. At first, when I first watched it a long, long, long time ago, it didn't make sense to me, but when I watched it a few weeks ago, it was like, now I know what the Ood Sphere is. Now I know what the Cryons are.
I thought that was
the triumvirate of the Ood Sphere contains the Cryons, the Ood, and the Sensorites. And I was like very impressed.
I love the sense sphere stuff as well, when they were looking out of that big window and they were just peering in and sort of floating around. That was quite cool.
I think I'm going to have to watch it again to understand it a bit more.
I lost my copy, but luckily ITVX player is now showing every single classic Doctor Who. So I was in heaven I've never watched so many Doctor Who back to back in on the TV like that before. So I managed to get the Ark of Infinity, Greatest Show in the Galaxy, Destiny of the Daleks, the Sensorites. It was brilliant.
Can't believe. Well, what impressed me was that the Sensorites didn't really want to hurt the humans. They just put them back in their rocket, said, "We'll feed you, we'll water you, we'll keep you as pets, cum prisoners. But we don't want to hurt you," even though later on, spoilers, it is revealed that a previous team had done the Sensorites a little bit of dirty.
Yeah. And that's what I mean. That's what I like this story. It's the Sensorites' conflict with each other was fascinating. But in terms of a Doctor Who story, it felt like it was the Sensorites and Susan that were really leading the story. And as I say, it feels like you know what's coming for Susan. We know the Daleks were coming for her soon, but you could feel like this is like you could start to see the production was winding down on her. So they gave Carol Ann as much as they could do before she got out of there. Would I say this was one of Susan's finest hours? Yes. Would I say the rest of the crew? Not really. I really like the whole dynamic between like that really shady one who stole the sash. And then when he put the sash on, it was like they couldn't tell the difference. It's like for a race that's supposed to be connected with one mind, they couldn't tell who was who. So that's what I thought. Was that supposed to be a production error or was that a budget of the time? Because obviously now things like the Ood, with the Ood sphere, they'd all know who is who, where you would have thought the Sensorites would have known like who was being actually the manipulative one underneath all of that.
And to take away the lock of the TARDIS as well, I thought that these must be powerful beings to have manipulated the TARDIS. And I thought to myself, would they... If they realised the Doctor was a Time Lord, would they have used that to their advantage to hijack his machine and stuff? But it didn't seem to get in the way.
Because that's the first time that happened, wasn't it? When that's been the TARDIS has been hijacked back in the 60s. And I don't think it has been hijacked since then, but I can't remember. I need to watch more to find out. But it was a way the lock wasn't there. And Susan goes, grandfather, the lock is gone, the lock is gone. You see, she's taken over, like Matthew said, it's taken over the role of the whole cast, I think.
And it was I was interesting that they are scared of high-pitched sounds. So God knows what Bonnie Langford would have done to them.
Oh, lovely. Apologies, Bonnie. There's a disclaimer going out for this episode.
I love Bonnie, though.
Me too.
Your Big Finish Mel all the way. TV Mel, that's another debate. Yeah. But anywho, for the Sensorites, do I think they would have had fairer writing if they'd come back again? Yes, because obviously a different writer might have been like, okay, so this is what worked for them the first time, but can we do something a lot different so that people can see there's a rich history towards them? And there really was, and we've never seen it again on TV. I think if they really want to, Russell's mad mind could literally pair them with the Ood for like comparison of like with the richness between both races.
And Big Finish, if you are listening out there, please give them another chance.
Yeah.
Yes, we've already had, as I said, Susan's War, which revisits Sense Fear, and she's dragging into it with her and Ian of all people. It's like oh my gosh, it's Susan, I can't believe it's you. And he's like, I'm not the Sensorites again. He's literally moaning when he sees them again. He's like, I thought they were evil, you know, like those people from last time.
They were only evil because they had something done to them to make them evil.
Of course. Well, the Ood, they physically get manipulated like virtually all the time. Like, I kid you not, how many times have the Ood have been so manipulated? Like when you watch them, it's like watching the Sensorites. They're really nice and humble people. But they went back to
the Ood nation. Sorry, Matt.
I'm sorry, you're going, Craig, so I couldn't hear you.
They talk about this Sensorite nation as well. So you think, like, was that just the tip of the iceberg? They could do so much, you know.
Right. Were there female Sensorites? Were there children Sensorites? Were there schools? Where's the offices? Where's the playgrounds? Not just the tunnels, not just the waterways, but and not just the weaponry, but everything else.
You never saw that, did you? You never saw anything.
They talked about the water in the spring, but then...
The crystal water, and then the water that everybody else drank.
Yeah, and this is why it's worth a revisit, like under the New Who budget, because you'll get to see the rich side of what the Sensorites, which wasn't able to be you could get that sense, like, this is a few years down the road, it's a bit decrepit, but it'd be nice if they could do, like, a story which explores their rich history about, like, what were the Sensorites like before, like, the TARDIS crew met them. Like, obviously, they could have a new Doctor, like, could have met them, because you know what the show's like, you can always meet them in the wrong order.
Right, so we could have new show up and wind up meeting the Sensorites decades before the humans even showed up looking for a molybdenum.
Absolutely, the Doctor could meet them, so it doesn't contradict if he's traveling alone or something, or she, depending
that
which
might
incarnation.
Be an interesting prequel as to how the Sensorites knew to pick the TARDIS lock.
Because they could have met a Time Lord before.
But in which incarnation, and maybe is it the same Time Lord, or is it a different Time Lord they met? Maybe they met the Master. You never know if they met the Master.
Oh, it could be the Monk. It's always the Monk somehow.
Oh, it burns to be the Rani.
I want to see the Rani again. I need to see the Rani again.
We still need to resolve those rights issues. Unfortunately, when Pip and Jane passed, the rights are still gone to the estate.
Forbidden Planet have just launched the 60th anniversary pin badges, and one of them is the Rani. I managed to get the Master, a Roger Delgado, and a Sutek one. But they're really nice pin badges. They're so cool.
I'm really liking the artwork stuff they're doing for the 60th at the minute.
Yeah, you can get prints.
Guess who has a pin badge, mate? I can make them.
You want?
Oh, wow.
Oh, excellent.
The machine that bits in, pull the big handle, and out pops a pin badge.
Wow.
That's amazing. Okay, send some over Ramona.
We need a Ramona over here.
We need a Ramona to make a Ramana.
Yeah. She's a time lady.
We're not the one you're expecting.
So what do we think of overall, who was the best out of the characters, from the Doctor to Barbara? Who do you, Matthew, what's your...
Well, I think you already gathered from my hints earlier. I would say this is a Susan story. I'd say this is the finest hour for Carolyn Ford. And it's such a shame. Like, she was literally leaving in about the next episode or so. It really felt like the writers knew they did her dirty with, "Ow, my ankle!" Like, some of the episodes. It felt like that was, like, virtually gone with this one. She seemed more confident. The clash between her and her grandfather was literally coming for, like, the Daleks' invasion. If this is literally how she was going to be all the way through series one after the pilot, you would literally have thought, this is an independent woman. She's a young girl trapped in, like, she's ancient, but she's in a young girl's body to us, the audience. And then when you see her leave, it would have been a stronger journey if this is how they ran with Susan, like getting to use, like, the telepathy side more, getting her to use her wits. And even if she's scared, she needed more guidance rather than, "Oh, I've hurt my ankle conveniently. Oh, oh, that's a twig, like, literally 20 feet away. Let me fall." But all in all, I'd still think this for her was her strongest, and I like her connection with the sense sphere the most, because with the Sensorites, she feels like she's so alone and so isolated, still traveling with her grandfather. Even though they've kidnapped the school teacher, sometimes she can't relate to them because she's not human. So it's nice that for the first time in this series, she relates to aliens on her level.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree with you there, Matthew. I think for me, it was Susan who outdid everybody in this story. Her views, her values, her morals, everything all comes together. And it makes way for her exit. As like you said, it makes way for her exit in the later series.
And last note is, I'd say if you have never watched classic Kubrick, you're aware of Susan, this is, don't be fooled by the hold me ankle business. I think this is her strongest story, and it's such a shame that it's one of the last stories with her on telly.
Ramona.
Yes. What I've seen is that she is portraying Time Lord ladies as being delicate, even though they're long-lived, but it's their mental powers that come to fore when it comes to a situation. And while male Time Lords have a limited amount of telepathy, it's more pronounced between the Lord and the TARDIS, it's the female Time Lord ladies who have stronger telepathic powers. And she was able to receive communications and communicate back to the Sensorites on a private channel instead of communicating out in the open, and anybody else can just butt right in.
Cool. What about you, Craig?
I like the telepathy aspect of this serial, because you didn't really see much of it until around maybe the Silurians with their telepathic gifts and ways of communicating. I love the design. I think Raymond Cusick was the designer on this. It always looks classy, like, no matter what they were filming in the 60s, it just is so bright and sharp, and they spent a lot of money on, it looks like they spent a lot of money on the set designs, which is nice.
Considering set conditions for filming, it's a hothouse in that studio there.
Mm.
So wearing Dr. Denton's full set suits, I have to give them props.
And I would say, for me, I enjoyed the story. I mean, it was a bit slow going at the beginning, but once you got into it, it was good. And it done well on the figures as well. I mean, they got around 7 to 8 million viewers. For episode one was like 7.9 million. So it was well received. But yeah, there's a lot of comparisons with the Ood, like you said before. Yeah, it was a good show. I mean, I thought it wasn't as strong as the Aztecs, but then that was Susan's strong story. But it was a nice, it was a good story, and I think it flowed well, and you know, we got to see a side of the Doctor that was again different. He didn't seem as ruthless in this episode. You know.
Yeah, I can just say on that one, it felt like that was the start. Like, this was like that turning point for that wise old wanderer to suddenly realize that he's no longer that alien and starts becoming the person that we've seen today with the show. I think when Vicky started to arrive in the couple of episodes, this is literally the layers about to come off him.
Sorry.
Best scene for me was the cloak scene where the Doctor gets his cloak back and Sensorite.
I think for me, it's when Susan just told her grandfather, no, listen to me, type thing. That's, you know, I thought, you go, girl, you know, this is your time now. You need to stand up for yourself. That's, for me, that was the most pivotal point for her, I think.
But yeah, if the next episode was Dalek Invasion, you could tell that would have gone really nicely, like, absolutely, to end on like their relationship, with the next story being like why they're parting.
I wonder, I'm looking forward to the Reign of Terror, because it's going to be a complete contrast to what we've seen before. And it's another historical setting. So I'll see if it marries up to the Aztecs. It'll be interesting. And I've never seen it before, so it's for me.
I've always heard mixed opinions on the story, animated or not, so it'll be quite interesting to do that one.
I love the animation for it, so this is going to be a good one for me. And I love historical settings as well, so it's going to. I'm looking forward to the Reign of Terror next.
So I watched it about a year ago, and it's a tough watch. Whether it's the reconstruction or the animation, it's a tough watch.
Okay, I'll make sure I'm bright-eyed and bushy-tailed for it.
Lots of coffee.
Yeah. Oh. Double espresso.
I've got some.
So, guys, what would you give this as a rating then?
I'm going to give it 3 out of 5. Only because I didn't really connect with the whole story. And sorry, everybody, that's just my opinion for that. But I love Susan's, you know, because it belonged to Susan, this one. And Susan, again, was top for me. So I'm just going to give it a 3 for that.
Okay. And Matt?
Yes, to me, I think we've come from a really strong series of like really strong episodes, from kidnapping your school teachers to weirdly cave people to gimps, to aka what would they call the board. We've done the Aztecs, and here we are nailing at the finishing line of the original team. Mm-hmm. And is it one of the strongest stories? I mean, we've had like The Edge of Destruction, we've had so many others, right? But for me, it's Susan's strongest story, but in terms of Doctor Who, it's not the strongest for that first series. Would I say it's rewatchable? Yes, it's fun. So my score rating for it is 3.5. It would have been a lot stronger if the crew had more to do. It just felt like the Doctor and Susan were leading the story, and it felt like Ian and Barbara were just like non-existent. It was like, okay, there's the Sensorites. We're coming to the climax of like this crew, and it feels like we barely had them like together in these last two episodes. So who knows? But I don't write off the story, but it's a great character piece for people that want to see more out of Susan than just, help me, girl.
Yeah. And Ramona?
I'm wavering between a 3.5 to a 4 because it took a long time for the story building to actually get established. They spent a lot of time with the mind-broken character and just dealing with the psychological traumas and being scared and pulling him out before we finally get to go planet side and see exactly what's going on. You know, the crew pictures, photographs, mementos from the previous human expedition, and onward from there. Unfortunately, I did not get to see episode 6. My source did not have that available, but of what I did see, I enjoyed it.
Great.
I'm sort of on the lines, just like Ramona. I think I'll give it 3.5. I like the concept. I like the characters. It was fun, but it took a while to get going. But it was nice to see the Doctor's cloak. That was cool. And yeah, that's what I'll give it.
I, I think the most disappointing aspect is the war side. Like, you really want to see where this is going and everything. And it just felt like it was really rushed out. Like, it was resolved too quickly. And that's when people go on about, I'm sorry to keep using him, I know people are sick to death here, like Chris Chibnall, like, when you literally rush characters out, I see why people get frustrated. Like, you build up the story, but a six-parter, and they've literally rushed everything. You could tell they were literally winding down. But I personally believe this should have been an arc for Susan, starting from the Aztecs. If she was winding up leaving, she should have started making the frustrations known an episode or two earlier about why she's having a bit enough of traveling with the TARDIS. There should have been a bit more confident. Oh, by the way, it's Sensorites. And then you don't see anything until goodbye, I've been locked up with the own TARDIS. But that's just me.
I agree with you. I agree with you there, cold-heartedly, because it's, I should have mentioned it right at the beginning, six episodes long. Whereas if they wanted it shortened or maybe done quickly, it should have been a four-parter in the end, but not too many characters. For a point of view, there was too many side characters in this whole episode, I think.
So, guys, that brings us to the end of the Literary License podcast for today. Do you have anything you want to plug? Any social medias and stuff?
I'm on Marius Wright on everything, on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram. And please follow me and subscribe to my website, and you will get a free magnet book coming soon as well, so look out for that one in the next month or two. So keep subscribing and keep messaging me, and I'll get a magnet book soon to you as well for free.
Sounds cool.
Ramona.
Well, you can visit my wall on Facebook. Everything is open. Albums, pictures, photos, artwork, it's all open, so you can see my builds, from TARDIS consoles to the structural reorganization system of the TARDIS that looked like a great big tree with the light pods hanging down, that I built as a model that actually lights up. And even when you turn the power off, the light pods stay lit for about 30 seconds because I painted them with glow-in-the-dark paint.
Wow. You can check all my shit out on craigsworld.org. Links to everything on there. Check it out. And you can check out the Literary License podcast newsletter, llpodcast.com. You can see Ramona's links on there. Everyone's links are on there. Just check it out.
Disclaimer, he means his actual stuff for sale, not stuff on the toilet, people.
And Matt, you're having something in the Doctor Who Appreciation Society magazine, isn't it?
Yes, don't forget to subscribe to DWAS, as it's also shortened.
Cool.
Yes. Yes. So, for socials, you can just find me anywhere. I'm literally virtually, I'm a tsunami. You can find me on Facebook, you can find me on Instagram, you can find me on TikTok, Twitter, Mastodon. I'm everywhere on this planet, from photography to literally anything. And don't forget, Craig will also want your blood, your money, your pictures, all to go to DWAS.
So guys, we'll be back in maybe 2 weeks for the Reign of Terror. So it's good night from me.
And good night from me.
Good night from me.
Yes, hey, hey, a venture to ship and a good night if I had a cup of coffee. Shouldn't stop screaming.